They usually give me the right after lunch slot, which is awesome because I can say anything because everybody's asleep anyhow. So I'll sit up here and read the phone book and still get good rating. I hate the last slot of the day because you're the speaker that's between the audience and the beer, and that is a bad thing. Would you do me a favor and close the door if we're going to get started?
Seriously, they don't lock. You know, I just wanted to.
I don't want to disrupt those people that are actually out there doing some work. Hi there. My name is Cal Evans. We're going to talk about PHP for the CLI. First of all, who was in the last session in this room? Anybody? It was a good session. Emma did a great job, but it was more of intro to the command line in general. We're actually going to talk about PHP from the command line. Who out there has heard me speak before? All my jokes are new. Awesome. Okay, Russ, you don't count.
So, he's seen me talk. I have four jokes that I've been using since 2006. If you see him laugh, laugh. Okay, that means you're supposed to. Doesn't matter if you find it funny or not. Okay.
I don't know what you're expecting. This is pretty much a beginner's talk. If you understand the basics of PHP, then you've got enough to go on to see this talk. If you've done PHP from the command line already, you might pick up something, but this is the very basics of how to get started doing that. So just setting some expectations here. The doors are not locked. I was kidding. So you can slip out. I will mock you after you leave, and you can find something better. The code for this is available up on GitHub, GitHub/CalEvans/PHP/CLI, if you want to play with it. If this is interesting to you at all, and this project we'll get into in just a second, the sample project is fairly stupid. So it's not going to be something you can go, hey, I can use this in one of my other projects. At least I hope it's not. So, but if you want to, if the talk is interesting to you at all, I encourage you to download the code and play with it. One of the things that's going to drive you up the wall, because it drives me up the wall, is glasses. I'm old, but I'm new at being old. So I keep putting my glasses on. I can't see you. I take them off. I can't see the monitor. I do apologize in advance for that. I got to researching, because I decided to do this talk. I was invited to speak at Midwest PHP in the U.S.
Yeah, I wonder. So the okay. I was invited to do this at Midwest PHP. I might as well just pick the dang thing up and carry it with me. And I sat down and I wrote this talk, and I said, this sounds very familiar. And I got to looking, and I've written this talk three times for three different audiences. The very first time I wrote this was for the IPC conference in Karlsruhe, Germany. And at that time, it was very Zen framework focused because I was doing an awful lot of work in Zen framework. This time, we're actually going to use a symphony component, but it's not really a symphony talk. We're just going to use the symphony component because that's the easiest one to get started with. So, first of all, the question, why use the CLI, okay? I'm going to give you a few reasons why I program from the CLI. The first one, and actually this is zero, point number zero, is I am absolutely horrible at drawing anything. Graphics, color, theory, all of that escapes me totally. Now, I am blessed to be married to the lovely and talented Kathy. She is a graphics designer. If you see anything that has my name on it and it looks good, she did it, okay? But the CLI, I don't have to worry about that. I mean, the example I'll show you, we got fancy here and I've actually got colors, but that's about it, and it's not very good colors. I had to change them today because it didn't work on my my terminal anymore. But reason zero is, I am absolutely horrible at that. I'm much more comfortable and have always been more comfortable as a middleware or a back-end developer. I don't like designing screens. I don't like doing anything like that. And so I have found my love now designing things at the command line and designing APIs because you don't have to worry about it. It becomes somebody else's problem. But that's number zero. Number one is I just find it easier to use. Okay, I used to do a lot of the stuff that I do, especially from the command line, is just hip pocket or one-off programs. We've all done that. We write something. I've just got to move stuff from this database to that database and, you know, change everything in or change the capitalization in between. And you're only going to do that once. And yes, you could write this as a web program and have it output HTML to the browser. But what's the point in that? It's just a script. It's much more at home just running from the command line. So I find it much easier to use. Can everybody hear me, by the way? Because I'm not up at the mic. Okay. I have a tendency to be loud and boisterous. The mic usually blows people's ears out. Number two. I'm sorry? That's their problem, not mine. No, I'm kidding. You're right. They can't hear me on the video. I will try to stay at least close to the mic. Number two is a properly written PHP command line script can be part of a larger tool chain. Most of you who have used the command line on Linux or OS X for any amount of time know how to pipe things and tree things and move things around like that. And the Unix concept of you write one small one command that does one thing and one thing only, and it takes an input and it outputs the output, and you chain these together to get the desired results. Well, a properly written PHP script from the command line can be part of that tool chain. I usually find that I can get about 75% of the way there with the Unix tool chain before I have to resort to something like sed or awk, and I hate sed and awk, so I end up just writing the rest of it in PHP. But that's fine, because PHP gives me a lot more control. Another reason is for security. If you have commands, or if you have things that have to be done to your web application that you don't want everybody to be able to do, clear the cache or reset the database or whatever you want to do, you can write them and put them out on a URL and hope to God nobody ever finds them. Security through obscurity, or what I like to call the TSA model of web security. That joke's funny in the U.S., okay? Y'all don't know who the TSA is, and it just hit me that. The people on the video from the U.S. will be dying at this point. But security through obscurity is just hoping nobody finds the URL that's going to do something dangerous like wipe your database. Or you can implement a full-blown auth in that. You can implement a token or a login or OAuth or something like that, but that's a lot more difficult just to put a command out on a URL. Or you can use a command line tool. Because quite honestly, the only way they can run it from the command line is if they have access to your server through SSH or physical access. And if someone you don't want to run your scripts has access, physical access to your server, you've got bigger problems than I can solve in this talk. Okay, so it is much more secure. You log in, you have to be super user to run this, and that's the only way you can execute that command. But the most important reason, and I can't stress this enough, I'm lazy, okay? I find that I can quickly hack out a command line script, and I've done this several times. I can go in, I copy a composer.json file over to a new directory, I modify two or three things, I install the packages with it, and I'm up and coding within about 10 minutes, and usually about 25 minutes after I've started, I've got the what I need to get going. And it either works and I'm going to finish it up, or it didn't work and I've already moved on to the next idea. Okay? I'm very lazy about this stuff. I have probably 20 different commands that I use on a regular basis that I've written doing this, and they all started out with, hey, I wonder if I can do it this way. And this PHP gives me the, or PHP through the command line gives me very easy way to do that. Also, and this comes into play if you're working on larger applications. If you have a large web app that has models that encapsulate all of your business logic, congratulations, because that is the proper way to build them. But you know, you don't always have access to all of that business logic. And I can either, most of the stuff that I write, I could probably write in using just straight Bash. I hate Bash, but I could write it just using straight Bash. But then I'd lose access to all my business logic. And that's usually important and comes into play in all of these. Well, if your business application is written in PHP and your models are properly built and framework agnostic, meaning they can be instantiated without any framework dependencies, then you can use them in just about any command line script that you execute or that you build. And so all of your friends are right there because this is PHP and you know how to use PHP. You've got access to all of this. you can just start building and extending things and making them do new things. So that's why you use the PHP. Now let's talk a little bit about the how. Way back in yonder, PHP was originally written to work with Apache. Now, if you're not familiar, we're going to do a little history here. PHP was originally written to work with Apache, and it was encapsulated in mod PHP, which is inserted into Apache. And this is wonderful if you're using Apache. It really sucks if you're using IIS, okay? So the core team, those brilliant people that have volunteered their time so that I can have a career doing things like speaking to you, the core team decided, well, let's abstract everything. Let's make the server application programming interface, and then we will implement Apache as that, but we can also implement lesser web servers like IIS, okay? And so IIS now has access to PHP. Actually, we have quite a few of them now available to us, and this is not even a complete list of them. Yes, you see that right. PHP supports AOL server for the two people in the world still running it, but it still supports it. But we're really only interested in the CLI, and it acts as it is a SAPI, so it is the same interface that a web server would use to access this, but it is, some of the things, as we'll talk about, behave a little differently than if you were actually using a web server. And there are two major differences in that. The first, the header command does absolutely nothing. You can set headers in your CLI scripts all day long. It's not going to do anything. The header does not output anything. This is a good thing. We don't need headers when we're doing CLI, but it's also a good thing that it doesn't throw an error or anything. It sees that it's working in the CLI SAPI, and it just ignores everything that you're sending to you. And the other one, and hasn't always been true, but we now get plain text error messages. Back when we first got the CLI SAPI, we would get the same output when we got an error as we do on an error on the web, which means you get the HTML output, but it's output in a terminal window, so you've got to sit there and filter out all the HTML so you can figure out what the problem is. That was a real pain in the rear end. Thankfully, those days are gone. We now get just strained plain text for the error messages. Now, when we're talking about PHP from the CLI, there are two ways that we can do this. What I like to call freestyle, which is you put a page out on the web server and you use wget or curl or whatever your favorite command line tool is to hit that page and call it in and execute it. This is okay, but it's not really what we're looking for. And the OCD programmer in me says, that's using the web server. I've got all this overhead for a web server that I don't really need because I just want to execute this script. And you also, like we talked about earlier, you've got to put authorization checks in there or you've got to hide it and hope nobody finds it. This is not a good thing. The reason we would do this, though, is we know these tools. They're handy. They're right there. If you're working from the CLI, you've got wget or curl that you use on a regular basis and you understand them. You know these. They're your friends. It's easy to put a command into a cron by doing this. You just wget and the URL. You don't have to worry about pathing or anything like that. It just works for you. And you can use existing code as is. Your web framework already knows how to instantiate the model. Your controllers understand how to do this. You already have views that are outputting stuff, so you understand how to do, or your framework understands how to do this. You have access to all your tools. It's just easy, and it's a paradigm that every web developer understands, whether you work at the command line or not. So most people, when they make the transition to working in the command line, they will initially start with bash scripts that are doing this, and they will call a PHP script through a web server and output it. Hopefully, I will inspire you at least to move beyond that if that's what you're doing now. Because there is a better way. There's a better way to call our code from cron jobs. There's a better way to build maintenance scripts. And I do an awful lot of that. I have a little side project that I have to work on a monthly basis, and I had to, it was one of those, I'm having to move data from this service to this service, and I have to update everybody's subscription data and stuff like that. And it just got to the point where I was doing a lot of this stuff manually. I said, well, you know, okay, I can take this and make it a script, and I can take this and make it a script. Well, the project has grown to the point where I don't run it by myself. My wife runs most of it these days. And she came to me the other day. She says, well, if you'll just show me how to do this, I'll run it myself. And I said, oops, well, here comes the problem with it. It all sits on my local laptop. So there are a few downsides to this. If you do this, push it up into a Git repo or something so that other people can get to it. She's not a programmer. She's a designer. So she was hoping for go to this URL, click this button. So that's going to be probably the next step in or the next evolution of these. But there is a better way for us to be able to build our maintenance scripts. It's not exactly a new way, though. We got the PHP, we got the CLI SAPI in PHP version 4.3. And the first time I saw that, I got really excited because I was like, cool, because now I don't have to worry about all the HTML stuff. I can just do the stuff that I'm interested in. And I dove into it, and in 4.3, I actually build an object-ish mail system handler, maintenance scripts. I could issue a command and add a domain name to my mail server. And I could add accounts and I could delete accounts. And all this was stored in a database. And yes, I realize storing mail in a database is a bad idea. But that's a lesson you really only have to learn one time. Okay? But I built all of this. And it was 4.3, so we didn't have true objects. But it was object-based programming. And it was eye-opening to be able to do all of this. And that was where I fell in love with building more and more of these scripts. But there's actually several ways. How many of you actually use a framework for PHP? Okay. Chances are good if you're using a modern-day framework, they have CLI support built in. Laravel, Zen Framework 2, Symfony 2. We'll be using the Symfony 2 command, Aura. Keep wanting to call it Aurora. Aura has it built in. All of these already have these built in. So the concepts that we talk about are still going to be applicable to you, even if the commands that we're going to show, or I'm going to show you here, have to be changed. But in reality, this is not I'm going to show you step by step how to do this. This is one of these, I want to show you what's possible, hopefully inspire you to take the next step. So the sample project. We're moving fast. I talk fast. We're going to get done early. The sample project. I never like sample codes in talks to be useful code. And by useful, I mean something that you could take and look at and say, hey, I could use that in my own project, okay? Because when you do that, or every time I've done that, what I have found is that people get wrapped up more in what the code is doing than the concepts that we're implementing. So the sample project that I have for you today is a command line Twitter client. You're welcome. I know. The first question you're asking is, Cal, how can I monetize this? Twitter's been asking that since they began. So, no. thank you. Okay, you're awake. Good. As I tell all my audiences, the jokes don't get much better, but if you don't laugh, I will tell more. Okay? We need the blink tag to come back because this really needs to be blinking at you. We're going to do a Twitter client. But first, like any good programming project, let's shave a yak. Okay, we've got to do a little research. I'm going to explain a few all the moving parts to you. We're going to set it all up and then we'll play with it. So the first thing we need to do is set up our bootstrap. Now, the way Symfony operates is I have a bash script that has PHP set as the interpreter. Now, I had somebody, I did this talk at DrupalCon LA, and I had somebody ask, well, couldn't I just say PHP and the name of the script? And yes, you certainly can, but you don't have to. If you're using Unix or OS X, and you have this set with the proper execute permissions, then you can run this script, and basically that first line tells Bash the rest of this should be interpreted with PHP. If you're running it with PHP, PHP just sees a comment, boom, we're done. So, this is, oh, I don't need that. I'm not going to go through all of this. I'm going to talk about a couple of pieces of it. The first thing is we use the Composer Autoloader. Now, how many of you are using Composer? Congratulations. The rest of you, please start. Okay, Composer is one of two or three tools that have changed the way program or PHP developers operate. It is a fantastic tool. I guarantee you, if you learn how to use it, it will change how you operate, because the one thing it does for you is all of a sudden other people's code is very easy to incorporate into your code. We're going to see, I'm going to show you how to do that. But we have to bring in Composer's autoloader. That's really all we have to do. It sets up everything so that it can autoload our classes. Now all we have to do is get the namespacing right, which is a pain in the to begin with. But the name, get the namespacing right, and we've got everything. And you can see I use a command. I use the command subdirectory. So PHP from the CLI slash command. By the way, the backslash for namespacing. Everybody familiar with PHP namespacing? Back a few years ago, when we were just starting to talk about namespacing, the core put up a vote for everyone, not just the core developers. They put up a vote for everyone to see what to use as the backslash. Everybody eventually voted, and that was the one that got the most. If you go research on rfc.php.net, you can find that. You will see that there is one vote for colon, close parentheses, because I wanted the smiley face. I set that up. I voted for it. Just think of how much more fun programming would be if that was our namespace separator. But anyhow, we bring in the autoloader. We set up our configuration. Now I'm going to talk to you a little bit later about this, but that's all it takes to bring in my configuration settings. I'm using the .env package for my good friend Vance Lucas. It's available out on GitHub. This is not a sales pitch for it. It's really starting to sound like one, but it's available out there. If you've ever had to do configuration options for either a command line script or for your web server, it is just a fantastic package to use. It's one of those, it does its job, it does it well, and it's not trying to do anything else. That's it. You know, he's had people suggest, well, why don't you add this feature and this feature? No, this is what it does. So Vance does a good job of curating that. And then, once we set everything up, that's all it takes to actually set the wheels in motion, or as I like to say, do the deed. The very first time I spoke in Amsterdam was for the Dutch PHP Conference 2007. It was the very first one. It was a single track. We're all in one little room way over there in one of the smaller areas of the Rye. And I have had this bad habit all my programming career of when I don't know what to name a function, I name it do me. Well, that's fine if you're just writing your own code, but when you're showing it to 200 programmers and it says, do me, no. That one went over well with the Dutch. Okay, so that's all it takes. That's our bootstrap. The next thing we need is a model. Now, I'm not going to use any models in this. This is a do as I say, not as I do. All your business logic should be encapsulated in your models. All your controllers should do is be the traffic cop. Say, oh, you want to do this, we need this model. And once the output is done, you say, okay, here is to the view, and you hand it to the view. I don't do that. Everything is slammed in the controller in this example. But you know better how to program. This is where you would bring in your existing models. If you're working on a maintenance script for a larger application, this is where you would use your existing models instead of writing new ones. Then there's the view, because we're model view programmers, right? Model view controller programmers. But in reality, the view doesn't change with scripts like this. It's always going to output text to standard out. That's it. So in reality, yes, you could set up a view. You could use Symfony's component or any of the other ones, templating engines, to control your output. I have yet to find it necessary to do that when doing this, with one exception. I used to have a command that when I would set up a new development area on my server, it would run everything for me, and it would set up custom DNS for my local network and custom Apache config files. And I would use the Zend view to do that, but I would never output that to the screen. I was using it basically as a templating engine. I would save off the output and write it to the right place. So you can use a view if you want. I don't recommend it. I've just found it's easier just to echo stuff out to the screen, or in the case of the Symfony command, use the Writelin, which will output it for you. Then we have to set up our controller. Now, our controller in this, if you're using the Symphony controller, they're not actually called controllers, they're called commands. But it's the same function. The command serves the function as the controller. And then the config. Now, I told you a little bit earlier, I use .env just because that makes it easier. Basically, all .env is it reads in a text file, which is nothing more than a key equals value file, and it sets up environment variables for me with this name and whatever that is, whatever the value is. And if you understand how sessions operate in Unix, then you know that those environment variables are good only for the life of the program, and as soon as the program dies, they go away. So they're not permanently set. Nobody can get to them at a later date. One side note here. I've done this talk several times. One of the versions of this talk I did for the Dutch PHP conference here at the Rye. And I had a script that would send a text message to a phone number. And I was using a service called Tropo. A good friend of mine, Adam Kalesy, is one of the, he's like a VP of development over there. When I uploaded it to GitHub, I mistakenly left my phone number as the test phone number. You see where this is going? 3 freaking years. I got, this is a test. And of course, since I did it over in over here in Europe, the first year, most of those came in at 2 a.m. So, check in a sample config file. That's what we got here. The important thing to note here is you see that my keys are all in uppercase. That is a convention that I use. It is not required. The only thing you have to know is that when you're using these in your code, the case for the key has to match. Okay, so I use all uppercase. Just makes it much easier. The code that is checked in is the sample config. You'll have to create your own config. You will need your own Twitter account. Do your friends a favor if you have a Twitter account. And if you have a Twitter account, I do expect you to be tweeting all my jokes and that they're funny, okay? Doesn't matter if you agree with me. Just tweet out that they're funny. It helps me get invited to the next conference. But do your friends a favor. Go out and get a different Twitter account for development, okay? Nobody wants to see this is a test 14 times in your Twitter stream. But I've got, at last count, I have 12 Twitter accounts, and I'll use, the one we're going to use on this one is one from a project that I've abandoned, so nobody should be watching it. But you will need to get it. You'll need to go to dev.twitter.com while you're logged into that account and get your API keys. When you do, it will tell you, do you want it read-only or do you want it read-write? Do yourself a favor. Set it to read-write. Because if you change it later, it'll give you new keys. You have to go through the whole process again. This application is read-only. Okay, we're just going to search Twitter. But if you get ready to play around and do some more fun stuff with it, sending tweets and stuff like that, then you're going to have to regen those keys if you don't. So if you're setting up an account, then get read-write from the beginning. You're the only one that's going to be playing with this. It's not going to make a big deal. Okay, I talked to you about Composer. We're going to need 3 components in Composer. So we go out and I just issue these commands, require Symphony Console. That's going to install Symphony Console. I mean, it's very small. It's wonderful. Fabian and them have done a wonderful job at breaking these things apart so that you're not sucking in everything. Then I'm going to need Vance Lucas's wonderful php.env. We set that we do that. We've got an environment, we've got a configuration manager. And then we're going to need Zen Framework, Zen Service, Twitter. And when you issue that command, go get coffee because it's bringing in the whole Zen Framework. Actually, it didn't bring in all of it, but this will bring in probably 20, 30 different pieces. Okay, whereas Fabian and them have done a great job of breaking it apart, MWAP and them are still learning how to do that, okay? And MWAP is, for those of you who don't know, Matthew Weir O'Finney, Supreme Allied Commander of Zen Framework and now Zen Framework 2. He works for Zen, he's a great friend of mine. But that's going to bring in a ton of code, okay? If you want to look at the code directories afterwards, you'll see just exactly how much cruft that Zen Framework's going to bring in. But it's the coolest Twitter client that I found. I've been using it back when Twitter just had the basic auth. You could just log in to the API using basic auth. Twitter was the hello world. If you were working in APIs, it was just the easiest to work with. Nowadays, not so much. Okay, let's finish shaving the yak. We're going to flesh out our directory structure, which means, in my case, I have the directory that the project's in. I have a directory under that called app, which is just, that's where I put things. And then under that, I have PHP from the CLI. And I have to tell Composer where things are located. So this is my Composer JSON. You can see that I've got my three pieces that I required. It's already brought those in. The important thing right here is the autoloader. The PSR0 section, I tell it everything for this this project is located in the PHP from the CLI directory, and that directory is located in app. Okay, that's all you have to do. You set that up, you get that right, you run Composer update, it rebuilds its autoloader, everybody's happy. You don't have to worry about it. 30 minutes. Okay, we're not good. So let's look at some code. Well, I said let's look at some code. Did that work? Yeah, okay. Can everybody see that? Big enough? Okay. That's the wrong coin. Let's find my mouse. Oh, there it is. Okay. We have three commands that we're going to look at. I'm going to walk through in detail the first one. As you will see, the other two are basically, there's a bunch of yak shaving in each one that's exactly identical. There's no sense in walking through the detail on all three of them. So the other two I'll simply skip and show you the interesting parts. But this first one, first, I have my namespace. That way, Composer's autoloader knows how to load this. And then I load in the Symfony stuff. And it's the Symfony command, the inputs, the outputs, the requirements, all of that. And then I create my class, and it has to extend the command, which is the Symfony command. Okay? And this one's just called test. And if you're doing this, I highly recommend you create a test class like this. Never, ever check it in and push it to production. But create you a test class that makes sure that you can connect to, in this case, Twitter or your database or any important service. So that if something goes wrong, the first thing I do is I pop back and run the test command. And if Twitter is down, I know that never happens, but if Twitter is down, it'll tell me that, and that way I can say, okay, it's not my script, it's Twitter. 9 times out of 10, it is my script, okay? But the test command, that's all this does. That first function, laser pointer for the win, configure, has to be in there. Symfony's command module will look for this in a command, and this is just how we set up the command. We give it a name, which is test, that's what we will actually type in. We give it a short description, and we can give it a longer help. That's the real basics of it. I did not know you were here. I saw you tweeting, but I did not know you were here. Sorry. The next one is execute. If you're familiar with Java, this is your run. This is what's going to happen after Symfony finishes setting everything up. Let's get all the way down to here. Okay. Now, the output is one of your properties. I always save it off into a property of the class called output. I'm not going to show it to you, but if you check out the code, you'll see that I actually have a trait called WriteLine here that helps me with debugging and will only output certain things if I have a debug level set at a certain level, this kind of thing. And it depends on this output being existing. So I always save it up. This also means that no matter what method I'm executing in my test class, I have access to the output. Okay, so that's all that's doing. And then print to the CLI, that goes right down here, or print CLI, that calls PHP sappy name. This should, in every case, output three letters CLI. If it outputs anything else, you're doing this way wrong. Okay, because this is what PHP thinks it is operating in, and it's just going to show us that we have the CLI. And then I call Twitter setup credentials. Now, I love the Zen Twitter client. I've been using it forever. But it is dependent upon this array being set up exactly this way. Okay, so it's just easier to put it in the method. Now, you'll notice over here, I'm using the $env command because .env has already pulled all my configuration in and put them into environment variables. So I'm just pulling it out with PHP's built-in _env. Notice uppercase, token, secret, consumer key, consumer secret. Got to be uppercase because that's what I specified in my file. And then we're going to create the Twitter client using those options. And we're going to call verify credentials. And then we're going to call response to value. And response to value is going to give me output. Output is going to be the, if you just do a print R on that, it's going to be the largest output you've ever seen. So for some reason, Zen Framework sucks in everything at the kitchen sink when it's outputting its object. Okay. There we go. It's a Zen Twitter response object, and it's freaking huge. We're really not interested in anything in that except for the fact: do we have errors? If we have errors, output the first one, because there's only one. Okay, but they put it in an array. Output the first one. Otherwise, if there's no errors, output credential succeeded for and the account name. I'm going to show you what this looks like because this is just so dang exciting. Console test. CLI. Woohoo! That also means the network's up. If the network was not up, this is a very short talk because we're almost done at that point. Credential seeded for Nomad Ruby, which is an abandoned Twitter account that I just have laying around, and then done. I always output done. I don't know why. It's just I want to know that the program succeeded or made it all the way to the end. So I just put that line there at the end. Okay. That's it. So, as you can see, there are two required functions, configure and execute, you have to have. Now, in the you can see that it's certainly okay to put other functions in there, or other methods in your object. And by default, all of my methods are protected unless there's a reason not to be. I usually don't use public unless I want somebody else to be using them, and I find private just to be offensive because that means that me as the program has decided that you don't ever need to use this, and that's just, I find that bad. So, but I stick with protected functions and everything, and they just do the output for, or they just take care of the necessary functions. But I'm very big on breaking things up. I've got a friend of mine, some of you might know him, Raphael Domes. Anybody a member of Amsterdam PHP? Nobody. Anybody here from Amsterdam? Okay. Amsterdam PHP is one of the coolest PHP groups out there, and I know most of the user group leaders in PHP groups in North America and Europe. But Raphael has a great talk that's available on protalk.tv called Your Code Sucks, Let's Fix It. And one of the things he talks about is we have a tendency just to keep putting things into the main function. And he says the way you can tell this is if your code starts indenting and indenting and indenting and indenting, then you need to break that up into smaller and smaller functions. I think his rule of thumb is if you have more than two levels of indent, you need to break it up into another function. So that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make Raphael proud, so I keep breaking things up into smaller functions. Okay. That's the test. The test works. The network's still working. We're good. Okay. And you can see I used my write line trait. But here we define a few extra things. For my Twitter client, I've got several options. The first is, do I want English-only tweets? The default is no, but I can specify yes, because quite honestly, non-English tweets don't do me any good. So, but it defaults to no. Then the count. Twitter allows us to specify between 1 and 20 tweets to be returned. So if you don't specify, it's going to default to 20, but that's set somewhere else. But if you don't specify, it's set to, it'll return the full 20, but you can specify I only need 2 for this instance. And then only names, and I'll show you why in a little bit, but we have the option to only output the names of the people that are tweeting. So I set those as properties because I'm going to bring them in using command line properties, but I need to store them in my object. Now, you'll notice in the configure that this is new. Let's see if I can scroll that over a little bit. Nope. Okay. There we go. We're defining an array called definition. And this is the definition of our command line arguments. Now, the test didn't have any command line arguments that they specified, and the command itself did not specify any. It actually has about 10, because Symfony's console predefines about 10 of them for us. And this will eventually, if you do this a lot,
it predefining all of these will drive you up the wall because it's taken all the good letters. The single letter things, you know, dash E or something like that. Well, it's got dash B, so you can forget about using that for version for your script. It'll eventually drive you up the wall, but for right now, we're just going to define these, and this one is set to value none. English, it's just a flag. If you say dash E, it's specifying a flag. It's only going to give me the English back. Only names is a flag. Count, it's an optional argument, but it will take a parameter. And search term. Now, by default, if we specify this, it's going to search for pound PHP, because that's usually what I'm looking for. However, I can specify a search term with anything. It is optional. I use the dash S. Even though it says value required, because, and you can't see it, let's get down there at the end of that. That last little, there we go. See, I've got search term is the long command, S is the short, so I can do dash dash search term or dash S. And then in my help, if I specify help for the command, it's going to say the term to search for default is PHP. It is required, but there at the end, I'm setting a default to pound PHP. So it is required, but it is getting a value even if I don't specify one. Okay, back over here. We build that array, and then this looks exactly the same with the exception of we now have set definition, and that's it. Let's come down here. I pick up my properties from get an input, get option. I do not save off input like I save off output, because once you get through with it right here, you know, you usually don't ever need it again. But I do save all. I use get option to get my my English, my only names, and my count. And if you didn't specify a count, then it's going to use null, which if you don't specify, Twitter will automatically use 20. I come on down. I set my search options. If you've specified English, then we're going to use language. If you specified account, we're going to use account. Search options is an array that I'm going to hand to Zen's search component and say input, get options, search term, whatever my search term is, and then the search options, which is the array that we do with these two properties. That's all the properties that are there. And then we're going to process the response. We're going to do the deed. And we're going to process the response. And again, tweets is a freaking huge thing. We're really only interested in a subset of what's in there, which is the statuses. So we're going to send it to value, and then we're going to pull out the statuses array, and that's what we're going to spin through here. And we're simply using the Rightlin to say single tweet username, and if you, if I can get down to it, I'm just outputting it to the screen using the Rightlin. This is harder than you think when you're doing it this way. There we go. I'm outputting the username, and then two dashes, and then the text. The text is optional. If you specified only names, it will skip that. Okay. And then I set up Twitter just like I did last time. And then set output, which is just the way of setting the colors. If you're interested in how that works with Symfony, check out the code. It gives you an example of that. Let's see this in action. Console. Okay, just a basic search. Basic search spelled correctly. There you go. The green is the username, the rest of it's the tweet, okay? Just to give you an idea, if I say O and E, those are only the names of the people that have tweeted something in English. I know, you know, I see the stun. Half the room is stunned, I didn't know you could do this, the other half is, I can monetize it, you can't, okay? Twitter can't. But yeah, that's what it does. That by itself, not that stunning. Okay? But again, the point of this is to show you what's possible. And this is going to be a little more fun. Now, I'm going to skip all the cruft. This one is called Echo.
As you can see, it takes standard in. Everybody knows that you have a standard in file handle that's already open. If you don't, PHP has stdin. You can do any file options on that, any reads off that. You can't write the standard in, okay? It's not going to work. But you can do anything. It's already open for you. It's a constant. And basically, if anything's piped into this script, it's going to come out standard in. So I'm saying while I can get stuff out of standard in, echo it out with a counter, colon, and content. It just echoes things, and it's going to echo them back out, and it's going to number them for us. The point is not to do something stunning with the code. The point is to be able to do something like this. Console search only English. Let's pipe this to sort. Pipe it to unique. Told you, I always output done. I never want done in my list. So let's get rid of done. There we have it. We have outputted, we've taken all of them, we've written our script, and our script is now a first-class citizen in a Unix tool chain. We can even go one step further than that and pipe this back into console echo. And now they're numbered. The amazing thing is not that Twitter has not failed in the past hour. The amazing thing is we've written code that now works with a Unix toolchain. So if you're writing your own command line scripts, you don't have to write it all. Now, I know a lot of us in PHP do enjoy reinventing the wheel. I've got a stack of them in my closet, okay? But we don't have to, because Unix already gives us a way to sort things and a way to only pull out the unique things. And then we can pipe it back in. Now, I have to show you this because I gave this talk at DrupalCon LA. And in the audience was Miss Sarah Goldman. Sarah, if you do not know, is a core developer. She now works at Facebook. She's working on the Hack and HHVM project. But she wrote the SSH and SSH lib implementation for PHP. Okay, so if you use SSH or SSL in PHP, you owe Sarah a thank you tweet or something. She's a wonderful person. Good friend of mine. I am lucky to have a friend like her. But she said, hey, Cal, that's cool, but... And I'm going to copy and paste here. I've got these one here. I thought I was going to copy and paste. Oh, there we go. Yeah, okay. So let's get rid of all of this, and let's pipe it back into PHP. Did I screw that up? Oh, you're right. Sorry. Thank you.
PHP commissioner.
Congratulations. Pair programming taken to the extreme. This isn't nearly as embarrassing as being on... I used to do a two-week... tour where I would give the same talk over and over for 2 weeks and being in the last session at the last city, and they point out, you know, you got a spelling error in your slides. Nobody else could have told me that. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. We're still doing the search with only names in English, and we're going to grep out the done. And if you don't know the -v for grep, that's just exclude any line that says done. Okay, and then we're going to sort it, and we're going to pipe it to unique. But then we're going to take it, instead of piping it back into echo, we're going to pipe it back into PHP with the capital R. And what capital R does is says for anything coming into PHP, execute this. So since I'm piping it in, as long as it's got input, it's going to spin through this file. Now, this is a really stupid piece of code. It's going to print the name, colon, and then print the name with string reverse. Again, the point is not to wow you with my coding abilities. It's to show you what's possible. Okay? The dash R is a very powerful tool. PHP, you can pipe things straight into it. Again, we're using fgets on standard in. And we can tell it,
as long as you've got input, execute this. It's a very powerful tool.
This is also fun for those times when your in-laws ask you, well, what do you do? Well, here, let me show you what I do. Wow. Guarantee you they will never ask you that question again. Okay. Thus endeth the code portion. How am I doing on time? Oh, I got 15 minutes. Good. Okay. We're about done. We're going to get done early. I told you that. I talk fast. Let's wrap it up. First, I'm going to take a sip of what I really had hoped was wine. They really ought not put it in bottles that look like that. Got my hopes up. Because I have found that my talks, when I have had some alcohol, not a lot of alcohol, but I found that I enjoy them a lot more. Doesn't matter if you do anymore. I'm very funny drunk in my own head. So, anyhow, wrap it up. Why do we do this? Because it's easy. I find this so much easier than writing web-based tool, because I don't have to deal with the HTML and all of that kind of stuff. I can use JSON and PHP, XML if I have to, but I charge more for using XML, okay? But if you require it, I can do that. I don't accept jobs that require soap, you know? And those of you who got close to me know that. But no, I can't stand soap. I use REST. But it's easy. All my friends are there. I use this for maintenance scripts a lot. I run a project right now where literally I have 10 or 15 of these that I run on a monthly basis just to keep everything flowing. The very first time I did this commercially, and not the mail script, because that was not really commercially, it was for my own server, but you know, I was setting up email accounts for my friends and family. But the very first time I did this commercially was I used to run DevZone for Zen. If you've ever been there. It used to be a community site. Now it's mainly Zen stuff. That's not saying anything bad. But when I was running it, it was all community stuff. And we kept adding to it and making things. And we had tag clouds and all this kind of fun stuff. And the tag clouds were dynamic, which means, you know, they would load in via JavaScript. It was fun, but I got to realizing the more stuff we added, the slower it got. And it got to the point where it was taking 10, 15 seconds just to load the page, which, as everybody knows, that's unacceptable. So I started digging into the script. I used the Zen cache component, and I started caching the snot out of everything. But the problem I found is every now and then, I would run into an edge case where my caching rules did not work. You know, my caching rules were if I posted a new article, clear the homepage cache so that it would pick up the next time. And my tag cloud was cached for 5 minutes and all this kind of stuff. But every now and then I'd run into a situation that I just needed to wipe the cache. A maintenance script. I took 20 original lines of code plus the PHP Zen framework cruft that went around it. And anytime I wanted to, I could log into the server, boom, clear the cache. And not only did it clear that cache, but it would notify the other two, because it was a distributed server, it notified the other two caches to clear themselves as well. They come in handy, and you're going to find more and more uses for it. If you get comfortable doing this, you'll find more and more uses. If you use an IDE, you should not have any problem. I don't. I use Sublime Text these days simply because, you know, it'll open dang near anything. And trust me, I've tried. I've actually opened a JPEG with it. You don't want to do that. But it'll open anything. I just enjoy that more. I don't use an IDE. But if you use an IDE like PHP Storm or anything, it's going to work with this. You don't have any problem. Find a project and just write a script for it. See if it works. If it doesn't work for you, don't worry about it. But I think you'll find that you're going to find ways to make it useful. Up until recently, we could not have long-running scripts in PHP. By long-running scripts, I mean, you know, anything that's going to run for a minute or more, okay? Most PHP scripts execute in sub-second. But there are times when you want to process something large. I used to do this. I had a client that had 300 web servers that would generate a gigabyte log file every night, Apache web servers. And he wanted to be able to search these. So I said, okay, fine, I'll write a script and we'll suck them into MySQL. Dumb idea. But that's not the point of this story. I wrote the script, I ran it on a 10 meg file, and it worked beautifully. I mean, you were processing 200-300 lines per second. And I've got timers showing me that it's working and it's doing and how fast it's running. I said, okay, fine.
I pointed it to the right directory at 5 o'clock, I hit the button, I went home. I come in the next morning, not only is it not finished, but it is processing one line every 60-some-odd seconds. There's a memory bug in PHP up through 5.3. 5.3, they've cleared it up. We can have long-running processes. I have one, I have a little Mac Mini at home that I like to pretend is my development server, but I don't really do much development unless I'm running classes or sessions anymore. But it's my development server. I do have a script that has been running on that for 3 months. I have no intention of stopping it. Now, it's not constantly doing something. It will go to sleep for 10 minutes. It'll wake up. It'll check something. Hey, is there something I need to do? If so, it'll process. Sometimes it'll process for 2-3 hours, and then it'll go back to sleep. But I don't have to keep running it. I don't have to put it in a cron job, say, run this every hour. It's just a long-running process that's running for 3 months. We can now have these long-running processes. I am not saying write daemons in PHP. Please don't tweet that out. At DrupalCamp LA, they did. And one of the core developers who did not have context, he's a friend of mine, wrote me back and says, you're kidding, right? You would never suggest that. No, I wasn't suggesting that. Don't write daemons. PHP is not the answer to everything. But if you've got something that needs to process for a long time, we now have the option to do that, and you don't have to run it in a web browser and keep that connection alive. You can run a maintenance script, or you can run a PHP script from the command line, fire it up, let it run for as long as you want. It's absolutely wonderful. PHP is not the answer for everything. I do not believe that. I keep wanting to learn Ruby and Node and all these other things, and as soon as I find a project that I have to do that I can't do well in PHP, I'm going to learn one of those. The problem is all the problems that I have to solve run very nicely in PHP, so I just don't have the reason to do that. Anyhow, that's all I've got for you. My name is Cal Evans. You can find my blog at blog.calevans.com. If you do, stop by, leave a comment, because it's basically me and my mom, so I'd love to hear from you. You can follow me on Twitter if you didn't get enough of me here, but most of you probably did. I'm at Cal Evans. I work for a wonderful company called Pantheon. That's getpantheon.com. We do workflow and hosting for Drupal and WordPress sites. If you are in the market, come by the booth. I would love to talk to you. They've got a little demo. We can run you through. We'll give you a free T-shirt. It's all kinds of fun. If you have any questions, PHP, Drupal not so much because I do not have the deep inroads into Drupal, the Drupal community that I have in the PHP community. But I've been banging around the PHP community for 13 years. I know a lot of people there. If you're stuck on something, drop me an email. Chances are I don't know the answer. I'm not that smart. But I probably do know who does know the answer, and I'm happy to introduce you. Okay? And that's the wonderful thing about the PHP community. All of us realize that we're standing on the shoulders of giants, that we're using programs and things like Drupal that others have graciously volunteered their time for, so it's up to us to volunteer our time to help the next person down the line. So, that's me. If you have any questions, I'll be floating around at the booth. Thank you for your attention. You've been a wonderful audience.